Thank you, Brother Forsey, and I too concur with his admonition and challenge, and I believe it's right on target. And I tremble at the thought of our responsibility, sometimes quake at the thought of the responsibility, recognizing that we'll never be gathered together again just like we are tonight. And we've only come in this way one time. And may God sober my heart and my mind and yours. And, you know, revival time, we can't live with our fingers on our spiritual pulse. And but every once in a while, some introspection is good for us. And revival time is that time, camp meeting. Revival times are set aside when the saint of God can begin to look and see if there's been any cooling off in our relationship with our Savior, the lover of our soul, the captain of our salvation. And we can't afford to live always with our finger on our pulse, but we need to do it once in a while. And I worked in the factory years ago, the battery factory. We had had every year, maybe twice a year, we'd have inventory time. And so I've always felt like revival time is inventory time as well for my own heart as a preacher. And may God help us. And thank you, Brother Forsey, for that admonition tonight. Amen. I appreciate everyone that is here tonight. Appreciate those that are participated in the music. I love the music. I just love the good singing. You guys have talent running out of your ears. I want half of you that are talented to go with me. We have some pioneer places we want to place you that they need. Some that are talented. But I know Brother Forsey, I'd have to twist his arm. But maybe Brother Sutherland too. But anyway, we thank the Lord for his faithfulness to our hearts. And thank you for your faithfulness. I tell folk, I'm deaf in this left ear. I last church pastored 25 years. Actually, it was lacking six Sundays being 25 years. So that's close enough to say 25. And I had an orchestra to my left, and sat close to them, and the trombones and the trumpets and the baritone and the saxophone and every once in a while clarinet and blaring this way, and sometimes on the front seat some others blaring with some trumpets and stuff, blaring this way. And I tell them I'm deaf in this ear because of it. I last 25 years I put up with that stuff, but I loved it. Every minute of it, I loved it. And I love it. Thank you for your playing for the glory of God. Amen. Good to see some of the UBC preacher boys tonight. We spent last weekend with them down in Alabama. And we had a good time at the IMF. And appreciate these young men here tonight. Amen. I've always said on Wednesday night, ever since I've been pastoring, Brother Hand was my pastor growing up. And, well, I've already grown up, but growing out, he was my pastor. And he would say to us, don't you dare preach on Wednesday night. You want to cut your time in ministry short? Just do everything. Do all the praying. Do all the singing. Do all the Sunday school teaching. Do all the preaching. And you'll just cut your time in short. You'll cut your time short there. You'll cut it in half, he said. So you let other folk do it. Encourage them to do it. And on Wednesday nights, he said, it's people's night. Wednesday night's people's night. People need to report in. And he said, don't you be preaching on Wednesday night. It's people's night. And let them report. And so I've always said that. Years ago, we were pastoring in Louisville, Kentucky. And all of our children were home. And it was on a Wednesday night. And it was time for them to get on Dad. I mean, we're sitting around the supper table, Brother Russell. And they said, Dad, you say you don't preach on Wednesday night, but you preach every Wednesday night. And my wife even got in on it. Man, I tell you what. Honey, you do preach. You do preach every Wednesday night. You say you don't. But Luke, my middle son, Luke just took a, he was probably 12 or so, maybe somewhere in that area. He took all he could take. Of course, he was against me at first, but he come around. Aren't you glad when some of them come around? And he shoved his seat up from the supper table, jumped up and doubled up his fist, and he said, "Dad doesn't either preach on Wednesday night. He exaggerates." Well, exhorting to exaggeration is a long, I always said I exhort on Wednesday nights, and don't preach, but he had the E right, and that's about it. But anyway, we're going to try to follow through that, but you'll call it preaching, I'm sure most of you will, but because we do have a little outline on this Wednesday night. But I pray that God will help us and will sense his touch, and thank him for his touch last night. We need his freshness tonight. Amen. Have your Bibles with you tonight in Philippians, the New Testament, a little book, one of Paul's prison epistles, and started on his a missionary journey, then back again, and now in prison and cold, and writing back to the church that he loved dearly. He loved them all. And out of this four chapters, we want to look at mainly at the fourth chapter tonight, but the first chapter is just full. Right after Ephesians in your Bible, you'll find the little book of Philippians, but he uses words that he thanks God upon the very remembrance of them, and always in prayer, and thinking of their fellowship with him in the gospel, and how he longed for them and loved them and prayed that their love may yet abound. We find that affection oozing out under divine inspiration. And then in chapter 4, we find he shifted gears just briefly, and he began to zero in on two ladies, and then the rest of the church as well. And so with verse number 1 of the 4th chapter, and reading down through verse number 9 of the 4th chapter of Philippians. Those of you that can and care to, would you stand? I know we've done a lot of standing, but it might keep you awake for the next hour and a half. Amen. Well, a half hour anyway. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved, stand and long for my joy and crown. You see the affection still coming out. And so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. I beseech Euodias and beseech Syntyche that they be of the same mind in the Lord. And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Let your moderation be made known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Amen. Those things which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me do, and the God of peace shall be with you. Brother Phil Hord, would you ask God's blessing upon this message, messenger, and this crowd?
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Please do.
Speak to our hearts. Help us to be open. What you have to say to us, and give you praise and glory and honor.
Thank God. You may be seated. Love of the brethren is a distinguishing mark of those who have passed from life to death. I would like to pick out for our text to exhort to you tonight, out of verse number 1, these words, so stand fast in the Lord. In fact, stand fast, you could take back from the Hebrew, and it has a tenor of thread through it to be used in the midst of the battle, and it's could be considered a military command. Stand fast, stand fixed, stand settled. For you find when the singers were out in front of the army of Israel, and the many times in the hand-to-hand combat and trying to conquer their enemies, and the fighting in the fierce time of the fighting, the children of Israel began to sing or to chant. And those that are singers in the midst of the battle, and they would sing something like this, stand fast, stand fast, stand fast, stand fast. Oh, they didn't say it with that tune, sing it with that tune, but most likely they would begin to sing the Psalms. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. Many times they would begin to chant and would begin to sing. And as they would sing in the midst of the battle, they would use this phrase different times. You can find, as some writers declare, stand fast, stand fixed, stand settled in the Lord. And I thought again, if there's ever a day when the drift is on and when folk are ignoring guardrails and folk are ignoring warning signs, and the enemy, by the way, and I don't like to brag on him, but I want to beware of him, doesn't care which side of the ditch he can get us on. We can become so rigid and so radical. And I want to be careful using that because I believe this is a radical way. We believe it with all of our heart. But we can become so rigid and so Pharisaic in our thinking. Not too much of that around here, but it has been known to be around here and there. But the enemy is delighted if he can get us to go to the right. And he's also delighted if we would go with the masses to the left and let it up and letting down and throwing caution to the wind. But we hear the word of God through his anointed one as he declares to us tonight, stand fast, stand fixed. Don't be moved by the winds of change. Don't be moved by the direction that many are going and letting up and letting down and letting go. But let's stand fast, church. We've got to stand fast. We're getting close to the end and we've got to stand fast and fixed and settled in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now I recognize we can have, and I want to be careful saying this, but I recognize we can have all the standards of separation. And by the way, I believe in them from the top of my head to the sole of my feet, but it will not save us. We've got to have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. We got to know the blood of Jesus Christ has been applied. We've got to know and tarry until the blessed Holy Ghost comes. And by the way, the enemy is subtle in some of these things. Remember how he came to Eve? Thou shalt not surely die.
Right. Question.
God doesn't really mean what he says. But you know, the enemy's still saying that today.
Yes. Yes.
May God in heaven challenge your heart and my heart, yes, as we're determined to stay true and to stay faithful. Amen. Keep sweet in our soul, keep firm in our convictions, yes, and contend for the joy and the glory of God in our hearts and our lives, our homes and our church, and do everything we can to stand fast.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Paul told, I mentioned already, in prison, and he's writing back to this church, and he tells them, I want you to stand fast. And then he talks to two ladies first. But he gives us a recipe here. But I want to notice quickly these two ladies he talked to. A lot of times I'll go back to the 16th chapter and we'll look at the charter membership of Acts of the Apostles, the 16th chapter of the Acts of Apostles. You'll find the birth of the church at Philippi. And you'll find how God helped Paul and Silas in the midst, find Lydia, a seller of purple, and how she became part of that church. And you'll find a damsel that had been demon possessed and how God delivered her. And after she made fun of Paul and Silas, said, "These men who serve the God of the Most High show unto us the way of salvation." That sounds pretty good to me, but she was saying it in a mockery tone. And Paul had it up to here and finally turned and rebuked her, and the spirit left her. And those who were making her fortune on her fortune telling of her grabbed a hold of Paul and Silas and brought them before the magistrates. And they said, "These men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city." And they ripped their clothes off and beat their backs. And now they're in prison and in jail and began to sing in midnight hour in the hardest time of standing fast. But they sang to the Lord, and God came and shook the very foundations of that jail. And the Philippian jailer became a part of that church. I like to think he's a Sunday school superintendent. I like to think Lydia's a missionary president. I like to think that little damsel been demon possessed was the youth leader, and she'd tell those young people, "Don't you mess with the Ouija board, don't you mess with the horoscope, don't you mess with the spirit world, but you give your heart and life to God and serve Him with everything within." I kind of like to think that's part of the church that he's talking to.
Amen.
Here, and it is. But he says, "Iodius and Syntyche, I want you to be of the same mind in the Lord." Notice he didn't say the same opinion, because I guarantee you, as sweet as this gal is and as good as this guy is, I just guarantee you they don't have the same opinion on every issue. And I guarantee you this fellow right here and his wife, I guarantee you. By the way, I just kind of noticed something there. I thought your son's got the preacher's son on the other side of him, and he's got his mother and dad on the other side of him sitting with one of the preacher's daughters. I thought that's pretty good. I think that's the way it ought to be. But I guarantee you, you don't always see eye to eye, do you? Oh, Brother Hoberman, you love your wife. I see your arm around her, but I want to tell you, I guarantee you, you don't see everything eye to eye, do you? Oh, man, I thought he's going to. Brother Mark, you newlyweds. I say newlyweds. You see eye to eye? The altar's open. The altar's open. No. No, we don't see eye to eye. But he didn't say to be of the same opinion. But he said, actually meaning, you both can't sing soprano. One of you have to sing alto. Both of you can't be first. One of you have to be second. You need to not be in competition, but you need to be in complementing each other. And so he said, "I want Iodius and Syntyche that you be of the same mind in the Lord." And literally that's what he's saying. This is not a matter of one of you got to sing alto. I know you both have a good soprano voice, but one of you got to sing alto. And by the way, that makes it a whole lot better when you do that. Here we find this. And then he said, "And I treat other." He broadened it out to the rest of the church. "I treat other yoke fellow. Help those women which labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life." But here he gave some helps to stand fast. Let's notice in verse number 4. Here it is. Just exhorting on this Wednesday night. Here it is. If we're going to help you to stand fast, and you need to get on the praise committee.
Amen.
Rejoice.
Amen. Oh.
True. And I want to get there in a minute. First of all, let's notice the source of our rejoicing.
Amen.
What's your Bible say? Who's the source?
The Lord.
The Lord. Rejoice in the Lord. The season. The season. When are we to do it?
Always.
Always. Always. Always. Rejoice in the Lord. And the stress, again, I say, Rejoice. Brother Adcock used to tell us, class, listen. Anytime there's a repeating in God's word, it's not a matter of you and I trying to emphasize it, but the blessed Holy Ghost with his thumb in his back, and these fellows under divine inspiration are giving us God's word. And take notice, class. He would tell us over and over again, every time there's a repeat, take notice, it's God speaking, and God has a strong message for you and I. And if we're going to stand fast, we need to get on the praise committee. Amen. Wednesday night's here. Anybody got a testimony? The preacher says,
amen.
Next. All right, let's sing a chorus, Brother Glick. Let's sing, and so we sing a chorus, try to get everybody in good humor. Next. Do you have to do that here? Don't, I won't put you on the spot. But I want to tell you, I haven't been too many places when you haven't had to do it once in a while. Oh, you thank God when they can do it. You thank God when they do. He hasn't talked to me, but so I'm putting him on the spot tonight, but I want to tell you something. And we're just exhorting. But you want you to stand fast? By the way, do you all see eye to eye?
Sometimes,
that's right. Can you tell he wants to go home tonight? Larry Cooper said to me years ago, he said, I decided when I got married, I could either be happy or right. He said, I chose to be happy. Some of you know what I mean. But anyway, we're going to stand fast.
Amen.
We're going to have to get on the praise committee.
Right.
We're going to have to thank God from the depths of our heart. Most of you would not know Dr. Remus Rehfeldt, but back in the Church of the Nazarene, he was the longest sitting superintendent for foreign missions, world missions, up to his time. And the board of general leaders can recognize that he had some principle within and wasn't going to change, and finally put it on him so hard he had to get out of the general leadership of the church. But he was dying now, up in years, finished his last several years and out of Missouri. He was dying. David Easley, his pastor, came by to see him. Hospice had been in off and on, had a keen mind, but his body gone, wore out for Jesus down through the years. But here he is, dying, coming down to his deathbed. And David come by and visit him. His pastor said, Dr. Rehfeldt, I want to know how you're doing. He said, David, I just want you to help me get out of this hospital bed. He looked over at Sister Rehfeldt. She said, yeah, do what he says. David, I want you to help me not only get out of this hospital bed, but I want you to help me to praise the Lord. I need to praise the Lord. Would you help me to praise the Lord? David said, I helped that giant of a man out. Now, was it giant in stature? Probably about the Brother Russell's size at his biggest time, but he wasted away. And to about 130 or 40 pounds. But he said, David, now help me raise my hands. And David helped him raise his hands. Then he said, with tears beginning to course down his cheek, you're talking about a man that lived for God and stood for right down to the years, and not even knowing that it was his last few hours of life. Amen. Now, David, he said, will you help me to praise the Lord? I've got to praise him. Will you help me to praise him? And he said, David said, I stood there and lifted on one arm, then I lift on the other. He said, David, I need both hands in the air. Would you help me to praise him? Would you help me to praise him? Oh, David, we need to praise the Lord. Would you help me to praise him? David said, I felt like I was standing on holy ground and praising God, not because of who he was, but of who he was praising. He was praising the Lord. David, will you help me? Help me to praise the Lord. And David said, Dr. Rayfield, I've got church. I got to be there in church in a little bit. I've got to be there to open the doors and turn the lights on. I've got to go. Oh, David, will you help me to praise him? We need to praise him. Help me to praise him. And David said, I left him. I wanted to put him back in bed, but he said, oh, David, I can't. I've got to praise him. Help me to praise him. I need to praise the Lord. Oh, would you help me? David said, when I walked out and Sister Rayfield showed me out the door, he said, the last words I heard Dr. Rayfield say, oh, David, help me to praise him. We got to praise the Lord. We must be praising the Lord. David said, I'll be back after church. He said, we went through service. He said, I told that crowd, there wasn't a dry eye in that crowd as I told about. And Dr. Rayfield coming off of that bed and saying what he said with such conviction and such a firmness in him, and then did it with every bit of strength that he had left. Help me, praise him. Oh, I need to praise him. I must be praising the Lord. He said, when I came through, he said, I shut the lights out. And he said, I left about a little after 9 o'clock. And he said, as I pulled in until the Ray felt just ahead of me, the funeral director pulled in. A personal friend of the Ray felt family. And he said, he's there to get the body of Dr. Ray felt. His wife said, he's getting low. You might as well go ahead and come tonight. And he said he was there, and he said, although his body was still warm when I was there, and he said, probably, Sister Rayfield said, probably about the time you were turning the lights out of the church and getting ready to lock up and come, he breathed his last and went out into eternity. But this is what he said, left this legacy. Help me praise him. Help me praise him. Oh, we need to pray. I want to tell you, church, Brother Adcock used to tell us, class, you had him, didn't you?
Yes.
And by the way, there's a world difference of age between me and him. But anyway, Brother Adcock lived forever. But anyway, he used to say, class, if you can't pray through, try praising through.
Absolutely.
You remember that? He said, as two wings are to a bird, so is prayer and praise to the saint of God. As two rails are to the locomotive, so is prayer and praise to the saint of God. Oh, we got to praise him. It's going to help you to stand fast, church. It'll help you in the day of drift. It'll help you in the day of letting up and letting down and compromise of the word and the principles of God. It'll help you to stand fast if you begin to praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. An old timer used to come to my wife's home church up in Port Clinton, Ohio. I met her at Bible school, and she went there to get her MRS degree. By the way, girls, there's not anything wrong with that. That's a good place to do it. It is. All you fellas ought to holler, hallelujah. But God called her little girl to be a preacher's daughter, or preacher's wife. Yeah, she wasn't a preacher's daughter, a preacher's wife. And every once in a while, I have to still remind her of that, brother. Of course, you have to remind her. But I want to tell you, Brother Rife, who is from her home church, Port Clinton, Ohio, he'd come every once in a while. I was just a young preacher kid. I wasn't interested in what Brother Rife had to say. He was now had been off on the shelf. I wasn't really interested in what all the preacher, I'm confessing now, what all the preacher had to say, because I was there for that pretty gal. That's called to be a preacher's wife, and I was called to be a preacher, and so here I was there. Felt like it was made in heaven. Yes. That's what I was there for. But Brother Rife would get blessed. I'm telling you, during the preliminary times, when the preacher was dry-eyed, not exhorting, not trying to do like you did tonight, oh man, I loved every bit of it, of giving glory to God. But Brother Rife would jump up. And he'd turn around and look at that crowd, and he said, I want you to know, folk, it's a working, 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 it's a working. And sit down Then he'd jump up there. He had four phrases he'd use. And if he used them once, he used them a dozen times. And he'd jump up and said, "It's good, it's good, it's good, it's good, it's good. I like it, I like it, I like it, I like it. It's a working, it's good, I like it. And what's the next one, honey? I'm a papal nine times, forgot it already. But anyway, over and over and over and over and over. It's good, it's good, it's good, it's good, it's good. And you knew, Brother Rife was so feeble, but when he'd get up and stand and give glory to God and give praise to God. Amen. Praise. Here it is. Next, let's notice. Not only do we need to be faithful in praising, but in verse number 5, let your moderation be made known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. The word moderation could be called. We see a lot of things in that moderation. Actually, we see the theme of pliableness, of gentleness, of kindness, of generosity. All of that's involved. Let your moderation, let your pliableness, let your generosity, let your kindness, let your anything that would have to do with releasing your rights. By the way, we all have our preferences. Some like red, some like blue, some like blue and gray, brown and tan, whatever's in this carpet, they like it. I like it. I love these color pews. I like it. Somebody had to come to agreement to get them some years ago when you built this. Doesn't always have to be our way. So it's going to help you to stand fast. Let your moderation be made known unto all men. All men. All men. Let your moderation be made. My first church was Southeastern Avenue. Drove by it 3 times before I recognized the church. And it was in a house. And it was a fellow that had pioneered it had died and had surgery, an old man tired of being on the shelf, Brother Dorsey Skank, and he just actually Brenda Pitcher's grandpa who would have been. Brother Dorsey Skank, you would remember some of the Skanks, I'm sure, Brother Russell. He died and went to heaven, and the only thing that was left there was his wife and 2 other old ladies. And I was the 4th mark. They went by for a trial sermon. Literally Mark. Mark Bowery, Mark Miller, Mark Doddrell, and maybe the 3rd Mark. I thought there was another Mark, but anyway, 3rd Mark. Plus all the Johns and the Pauls and the Tims and the Rogers and everyone else, Brother Hank could get to go by. And I was looking for Indianapolis First Church, and I said, "Honey, I'll never come here. At least Brother Hank could do is tell me it was in a house. This is in a house. And grass was knee-deep, and nobody there to mow the lawn, and that house had kind of a apron, cedar apron to it. I went out about three foot, and the dogs ran rabbits underneath that cedar apron and tore half of those cedar shakes off and trying to get to those rabbits, and it was a disgrace. They had the church name over a window on a full sheet of plywood, and it looked like someone had probably busted the window out, and they put that whole sheet of plywood over that window, and you can see a little bit up here and a little bit down here of a big window, and had the church name, and I thought, wow, I'll never come here, but don't ever say that. That's because I got along with God Sunday afternoon, and that little altar in the front had 2 little, in the house had 2 bedrooms and a bath in between it, and had 1 row of pews, and people would come up, and you didn't know whether it was going to come to the altar or go to the bathroom. But anyway, because it had to come to the front to do it. But anyway, you'd hope they'd hit the altar sometime. And that's. But I got up and told those 3 ladies that Sunday night, one of them being the former pastor's wife, and most of them had been through the Depression, and they knew that it was hard, hard, hard scrabble. But I was too dumb to know that. I got up and told them I'd be their pastor. They all cried. My wife cried because she thought I'd already told her I wasn't coming. And she said, "What in the world are we getting into?" But here we are. We're there. But God, But God helped us until we got to, bought a bus. I said, talk to those old ladies and buying a bus. And our bus, we could hold more in our bus. We couldn't in our sanctuary. And we had kids coming, so we didn't have any place to put them, so we taught them on the bus. And put electric heater out and an extension cord out the window in the wintertime taught them and let the windows down in the summertime. And they burn up. But anyway, those were beginning days. We built a church building there. It's now just the annex now. We built a church building there. And I talked to those ladies about the color of carpet and the color of pews. And I love red. And I went to them individually because I knew what the former pastor's wife, I knew she didn't like red. She'd already informed me all everything she didn't like. And I was on that list part of the time. But she dearly loved me, but sometimes she didn't like me. I think you know what I mean? Because I was a kid, wet behind the ears yet, and just kind of, well, anyway. I just asked them all. And that dear, I already mentioned her name. By the way, it was the hardest thing in my life when she passed away. So I'm not talking about her tonight. If you'd have took a tube of ore, an 8-foot tube of ore, and swung and hit me in the middle of my gut, it wouldn't have hurt me any worse than it did when I got news that she passed away. I loved her and she loved me. But she was from a different generation than I was. And her husband ran a meat market in Brightwood to pay all the bills and to pioneer any church they ever pastored. And so she wasn't used to a young whippersnapper coming in and kind of taking over and an RPO coming down and said, when are you going to start this fellow's salary? She said, Brother Han, I don't know what you think we're made of. We're not made of money. We can't pay him anything. Oh, yes, you are. You're going to pay. No, we're not either. And I'm sitting in the board meeting. Brother Han said, you're coming in here. You might be on the other end of this one of these days. You need to know how it's done. I said, I don't want to do it that way. But anyway, here we are. But God, I wouldn't do it now, but I did it then. I'm just telling you this for illustration's sake. We built that new church building, and the other two ladies liked red, but this gal did not like red. Devil's color! Devil's color! I'm not going to worship the Lord with red carpet and red pews. You know what I done? I went down and ordered red carpet and red pews. I had the majority. I don't think I'd ever do it again. I'd honor her. And she liked blue, that's my second color, so we'd be blue. But the old Southeastern church was red. Red carpet and red pews. Red. They still have them in the junior church, by the way. I go in there every once in a while and I shout the victory. I said, hallelujah for this red. There's something about that. But anyway, I said, let's have 100 our first Sunday here. 100 first Sunday. How many believe you're going to get 100? The other two ladies raised their hand. And I mean, that prominent. Had a scowl on her face, too. That's just her makeup. I mean, we all have our own temperament, you know. But I want to tell you, we had 99 there. And I looked out them doors, and on the first Sunday, and I had seen a fella I've been calling on, and he got off the city bus that they'd ran very few on the Lord's Day back then. And he got off the city bus right in front of our church at corner of Grant and Southeastern, had a T-shirt, jeans on, and a T-shirt carrying in his hands, shirtless, and a pack of cigarettes in the other hand. I said, hey, man, you've been promising me a long time you're going to come. Why don't you come? I've got 99 people in there, and I need one more. He came and looked in the back windows. He said, preacher, you do have a crowd in there. I said, put that T-shirt on, them cigarettes in your pocket. Come on in here. And he did, but the only place he had to see, all of our people sat in the back, you know. So the only place he had to see, Sit was in the front, and Brother Hand was there, and he preached that Sunday morning, went straight to him after he preached and said, "Buddy, you need to pray. Why don't you come and pray?" And some of them old timers, that's how they did it. And so he came and prayed. I wish I could tell you prayed through and kept coming as a part of the church. He didn't, but I wish I could tell you that. But I said all that to say this. I don't believe I would do that now, because the word moderation, we need to be, we don't have to have our rights. It doesn't have to be our way. Someone said, "You want to split a church? Buy a carpet, buy a piano, start a Christian day school." I've done it every place I've ever been. Get in the building program, done it every place I've ever been. Except Okeechobee, Florida. I was only there a year and didn't get a chance to start a Christian school there. But anyway, in a building program and bought a piano and everything else and carpet. But I want to tell you, God, we're in this thing for the long haul. And we believe God's going to help us and he's going to help us to stand fast. And we're going to have to be moderate in all things. The Lord is at hand. He's coming one of these days. Plus, he's looking on and we want his smile. Amen. Quickly, let's notice. Man, I'll tell you, that clock's going faster than I am. I left out a bunch of this so I could get through exhorting quicker, but here, not enough. Here, hang on. Verse number 6. Rejoice. No, verse 6. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. We're going to stand fast. We're going to have to be people of prayer, earnest, persistent prayer. Pray. C.H. Henbest got a call out west to preach a revival years ago. Got that call and he went out and made a long story. He wrote back and forth, said, "I can't come that day you want me," but they kept sending him the same letter, said, "Dear Brother Henbest, we're having revival." Gave him the same date. They didn't budge. Said, "You're a called evangelist, please come." After the seventh letter, Brother Henbest got a hold of the place where he's supposed to be in that revival. The fellow said, "Please take that revival, and we'll take the latter date because the other Holiness Church in town's in revival. We always support each other's revival. So please take that. Please take that and give me a later date." So he did. Came to the place when he got on the train, headed out there from Ohio, out in Kansas somewhere, got off the train in the middle of a wheat field. He said, "I looked around." He said, "I didn't see very many people around there. And I thought, how in the world we're going to have revival here?" He said, "A man from the church met me." He said, "The pastor was running errand. And he said, I'm here to take you to the parsonage." He said, "Brother Henbest, we've been praying, God, give us revival. We've had some all-night prayer meetings. We've been fasting and believing God. Our church is too small to hold the crowd. We've rented the town hall for revival. And Brother Henbest, here's a prayer list of 100 names." He reached in and pulled out a list of 100 names that we pray to get saved. He said, "I looked around and said, I don't believe there's 100 people live in this community." But he said, "We went down to the little downtown, little general store, and met a lady from the church, and she said the very same thing. Brother Henbest, I'm so glad you come to be our evangelist. We're believing God for revival, been having all-night prayer meetings, been fasting, been believing God for revival. And our church is too small to hold the crowd. We rented the town hall. Oh, by the way, here's a prayer list of 100 names, same 100 that the brethren had." He got to the parsonage. The parsonage queen said the same thing to him. "Brother Henbest, I'm so glad you came. We've been having all-night prayer meetings. We've been believing God for revival. Our church is too small to hold the crowd. We rented the town hall for revival. Here's a prayer list of 100 names." The pastor got home and then told him the same thing. He said, "They showed me to my room. I laid across the bed and began to weep and asked God to honor their faith. Asked God to give victory in every one of those lives. And I prayed that God would give me his soul as well for me." 3-week meeting, he said, the first week, about a dozen of those on the prayer list came to the altar. And he said, before the folk would get out of their seats and come help pray them through, they'd all get in unison, get out their prayer sheet and check off the names. He said before that revival came to close, all 100 of people that they'd been praying for, they checked them off. And one more, 101. He said, "I wish now that I'd ask God for 100 for myself. But he said, I just asked for one. He said they lined up that 101 people all across that great sanctuary. And he said they took them in as probationary members of that church. The people prayed. Folk, we're gonna stand fast.
Amen.
We're gonna stand fast. We're gonna have to have some earnest, persistent praying and believing God. Oh, such simple truth, but such powerful. Amen. If we're gonna stand fast, church. Going to keep us from slipping, sliding, going down a slippery slope, or going off the other side until nobody has it but us. We're going to have to stand fast. We're going to have to be people of prayer. People of prayer. God in heaven, help us. My time's up, but let me just briefly give you these. Here it is. But he said, verse 7, and the peace of God which passeth all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. What are we going to do? We're going to have to have a mystery bag. That's the closest I ever got to it. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and your minds, the emotional, the physical, and the mental man as well. The peace of God, if it's going to keep you. The peace of God that passeth all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. We're going to have to be peaceful and ask God, the giver of all peace. We're going to have to follow peace with all men. We're going to, as much as lies within us, we're going to live peaceably with all men. Amen?
Amen.
It's the peace of God that passeth. Some things you don't understand, put it in your mystery bag. We're all fearfully, wonderfully made. We all have different temperaments. We all have different ideas and different strengths and different weaknesses and different ideas. And this crowd, I guarantee you, there's a lot from one pole to the other pole. I guarantee you. You say, preacher, you don't even know it. You're guaranteed. Well, I almost guarantee you. They're from one pole to the next. But when you don't understand some things, you put it in your mystery bag. When that mystery bag gets full, hit the altar and empty it out. And I used to tell the folk at Plainfield, I'm sure, Daniel's heard me say this, I think, I'm sure I've been in your mystery bag. I'm sure I've been there. Jonathan, I've been in yours, I'm sure. I've been in a lot of folks' mystery bags. But I said, don't carry me, I'm too big to carry around. Hit the altar and tell the Lord on me. Because I turned around and told them, because most of you have been in my mystery bag. But we can't let it trouble our peace. We got to keep our peace and our confidence in God. And there are some things you're not going to understand, and the devil is going to make them glaring. If it's not sin, now if it's sin, then I'm not talking about that. But I'm talking about different ideas, different suggestions, a different whether we get going to buy a pastor in Louisville once. I said we're going to buy a piano. Let's buy a grand piano, man. We're First Church. Let's get a grand piano. And a lady said, Brother Dodrell, I used to dance around a grand piano, and I'll not attend a church that has a grand piano. I'm a little smarter than I was when I got red carpet. I said, okay, although I probably should have went ahead and bought the grand one, but we didn't. I said, you know what, folk? And it began to influence some other folk. I said, we can get by without a grand piano. I like one. I think they're good. But you know what? We're worshiping the Lord. And so we bought a new piano, but it wasn't a grand one. And we kept that lady and kept her boys. And kept trying to help her boys and did help her boys. Took them to youth camp and so on. What are you talking about? Oh, here it is, the last one. Finally, aren't you glad we're there? Verse number eight. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good report, if there be any praise, think on these things.
That's it.
The things that are just and pure and lovely and honest and good report. Tonic for your thought life. The enemy's bidding for our thought life. Young people, listen to me. The enemy is bidding for your thought life. I want to challenge you. Think on things that are pure and honest and just and lovely and honest and good report. Think on those things. And when the enemy comes in, I'm not bragging on him, want to beware of him, but when he comes in to get your thought life going somewhere, say, no, I'm thinking on things that are pure and just and lovely and honest and of good report. And this is the benediction, the very next verse. Those things that you've both seen and heard and learned in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Wonderful.
It's a word. It's a word. It's a word. Some years ago, close with this. Some years ago at Plainfield, we started a Saturday night prayer meeting. We had a Saturday morning prayer meeting. Then we went to Saturday night prayer meeting. We went to different times when we get the most people there. Started a Saturday night prayer meeting. We had as high as 63. That's our record buster of Saturday night prayer. Because Saturday night prayer meeting, we only came in and the only thing we did was pray for Sunday services. Well, once in a while, we'd pray for other requests, but mainly we prayed for Sunday services. We prayed for all of our Sunday school teachers. God would help, and they'd sense that peculiar something that that comes from the Word of God as they have the responsibility and privilege of teaching God's Word. We prayed for our Sunday school superintendent, our song leader, our Sunday school pianist, our Sunday school organist. We prayed for all those that were in leadership during the Sunday school. We went to the worship time. We prayed for all of those that are involved in worship, our worship pianist and our organist and all the orchestra, and pray that God would bless. And our song leader, Brother John Whitaker, is our song leader. He needs lots of help from God. I'd say that if he's here, but he needs lots of help from God, and God would help him. And we prayed for him, and we prayed that God would help this preacher. I need lots of help from God, and we prayed for every one of us, and then we'd leave. But every once in a while, we'd only have just two. That's the lowest we've ever been. And that too would have been Tanner and I. I'd get him, he was one of my grandsons we're raising. I'd get him out of his grandma's hair. I'd take him over to pray. And back then he was a wiggly guy. And I'd get a hold of him. I'd get a bear hug and pray. You know, it didn't feel like being there because my 61 weren't there. Just the two of us were there. But here was there praying. Every once in a while, not very often, but every once in a while we'd be praying. And we'd pray for everybody. And then finally I said to him, Tanner, let's pray for your mama. Made some wrong choices in life, in the wrong direction, and is suffering today because of those wrong directions and wrong choices. Graduated from Bible school. Made got some wrong relationships and headed in the wrong direction. But let's pray for your mama. So I said, I prayed for her. Then I said, you pray for her. I wish you all could have heard him. I mean, he prayed like a house of fire. I want to say for about 2 minutes, but it was probably closer to 20 seconds. He prayed as loud and strong as he could. And as soon as he started with the fervency of a little child of faith believing God, he said, amen, let's go, Papaw, let's go, let's go, let's go. And boy, out we started. Now, 19 rows of pews, we got almost to the last row there. And, I forgot, Papaw, and turned around and started running. Now, we try to keep him from running in church, but only when you're happy or blessed should run in church. But anyway, he was happy, evidently, because he ran. And when he got close to the altar, I mean, he slid into the altar like he's sliding into second base. And then he said, God, I forgot. And this is what he said, forever changed me. Would you do all this with a cherry on top? Amen. You see that candy cherry on top of the milkshake? Top of a Sunday, It's his favorite. Mm-hmm. My mom, his great-grandma, spoils him. When she goes to Aldi, she'll buy a little jar of the candy cherries for him. Give them to him. He loves them cherries. Not as much as he used to now, but back then, that was his favorite. And I began to change my prayer, Brother Holbrook. Oh, God. Oh, God. Would you do this with a cherry on top? Would you do this? You see, his little lad had not to have things on him that he has for his mother is in prison tonight because she'd made some wrong choices. Thank God she taught here some time ago a Bible class. I beg her every once in a while. I beg her, honey, you've got to have a pure heart. You've got to have a pure heart. You've got to have a pure heart. If you're ever going to make it, you're going to have a pure heart. And by the way, church, if we're going to make it, we're going to have a pure heart.
That's right.
And we're going to have to keep pure. I thought of that little guy said, Lord, would you do this with a cherry on top? My prayer is, Lord, would you do this with a cherry on top? And by the way, I think he's more anxious to give victory and help and hope and help you and I to stand fast in this day when there's so many that aren't. Get your eyes off of those that aren't and look to him that'll help you to keep to help you to stand fast. Keep your eyes on him, and we can see the end of a Christian race. Let us stand.